So, in the mid-1980s, NATO had a problem. You see, countries that are hated by other countries usually spend a lot of time thinking about how they would defend themselves if they were attacked by an opposing force. In this case, NATO was once again pondering about ways to defend their territory if their sworn communist enemy was to attack them. And in the process, NATO found a weak spot in their defensive strategy that could become the reason for their forces getting brutally overrun and their reserve units getting caught by surprise by the Soviet army in case of an attack. In case you didn't know, that's a bad thing to happen. Before we continue, leave a like and subscribe to my channel. If we hit 150 likes on this video, I will show you a photo of my ice cream. Does it cost you anything to like this video? No. But it does cost me something to buy some ice cream, so it's a good deal for you. As you might know, the Soviet army's military doctrine partly consisted of their forces attacking in waves. So in practice, one Soviet wave would attack a NATO position and, ideally, weaken it significantly. Now that it's weak, a second reinforcing Soviet wave, which we call follow-on forces, would attack that position and break through it with relative ease. At least, that was the plan. These attacks had to happen very quickly because the Soviet army's doctrine aimed at defeating NATO without nuclear weapons fast enough before NATO could even decide to escalate the use of nukes. On top of that, these follow-on forces were to be supported by air power, meaning fighter jets to cover the air over their forces and presumably strike aircraft. NATO saw this as a problem because there was a risk that even if NATO forces managed to withstand the first wave of a Soviet attack, they would collapse because of the follow-on forces, which would lead to a Soviet breakthrough. This would enable the Soviets to penetrate the NATO rear. And this, ladies and gentlemen, was not a small problem. Because Soviet follow-on forces were not something like a large ground offensive. It was more like the exploitation of a small breakthrough by a comparatively small group of forces. So because it's not a meet-up of a bunch of men and equipment, it would be very hard for NATO to prepare for such an attack. Besides that, penetrating Soviet follow-on forces could encircle all the frontline units, hit NATO headquarters, attack air bases, and cut off logistics, basically strangling NATO forces into helpless destruction. And NATO had to solve this problem, so their military planners sat down and started thinking about a solution. One feasible option was to destroy or severely weaken the follow-on forces before they even reached the front by delaying, disrupting, and destroying them. This would give NATO forces a better chance at defeating each wave. And there were a few ways to do this. They could attack them while moving on roads, while stopped, or while being stuck in traffic jams created at choke points like valleys or bridges. Moving divisions are also expected to stop during their drive to the front due to several reasons such as traffic control or emergency repairs, or also for natural reasons like eating and resting. Such stops, where there's a large amount of high-value targets like tanks together in one place, would present a good opportunity for NATO to attack them. But this is easier said than done. Because firstly, NATO had to find the targets, and they needed surveillance and target acquisition systems to be inside Warsaw Pact territory to do that. The surveillance systems then also needed to provide the intel quickly after attaining it. Because, in case you didn't know, back in the day, one way to attain intel on enemy formations was by unmanned aircraft flying a predetermined route and just recording the ground below. These recordings would be saved on tapes, and once the drone returned to the airbase, these tapes would be extracted from the aircraft and processed. Only after that could they actually use the video it made to find out the position of enemy formations. And that process was slow as hell. So by the time NATO would have known where the Soviet follow-on forces were, they would already be somewhere else. But they had to work with that because they didn't really have anything else. Also, they needed aircraft to carry out these attacks, which would also have to cross the front line into Warsaw Pact territory. And if you're an OG viewer of my channel and have seen my video about the Shilka, you probably know that Soviet convoys are also accompanied by menacing self-propelled anti-aircraft systems that will tear you and your plane into 200 individually crying pieces. And NATO didn't want that happening to their precious $100 million jets. On top of that, NATO needed weapon systems to engage the targets, munitions to destroy the targets, because quite frankly, just hitting a tank with a small rocket is not the same as ripping it apart with 100 kilograms of TNT, and the survivability of their aircraft for both surveillance and attack so that they don't die on a one-way mission and so that operations can continue. NATO already had some aircraft that could potentially deliver thousands of tons of bombs per day, but they weren't quite satisfied with them for such a mission. To attack Soviet follow-on forces, they needed aircraft that could react quickly to new intel on where the formations were. They needed aircraft that could carry enough bombs to actually mess up the formation, weapon systems that could make sure the munitions reach their targets, and the ability to operate at night or in bad weather. In short, they had a lot with something, but nothing with everything. In November 1984, NATO officially adopted the concept of attacking follow-on forces before they hit the front. This concept became known as follow-on forces attack, short FOFA. At the time it was adopted, several systems from European NATO members were already being considered to be used in FOFA operations, which we're going to talk about in a second. But firstly, before they could attack the follow-on forces, they needed to know where they were. For that, NATO had a few reconnaissance vehicles in mind. One option was the AQUILA RPV, which was a small, remotely piloted vehicle controlled from the ground. And yes, that's a drone from the 1980s. Drones were difficult to detect by the enemy and didn't put human pilots at risk, but compared to larger aircraft with human beings in it, their range was limited. That's why the Lockheed Martin TR-1 equipped with an ASARS II radar was another option. The Lockheed Martin TR-1 was a newer model of the U-2 stealth aircraft operated by the United States Air Force. Yep, that's your product, my American Burger Kings. Stealth aircraft. That means it could do recon on Soviet follow-on forces. The ASARS II radar carried on top of the TR-1 could make images crispy enough to even see the difference between tanks, APCs and other vehicles. So you could not only see that there were vehicles, but you could also see what types of vehicles there were. But this would only work for as long as the formations were halted somewhere, since the ASARS II radar had a hard time spying on moving objects. So now you know where your target is. Does that mean you can go and finally attack it? No, you idiot, it doesn't. Because the Soviets possessed something called air defense that would shoot your aircraft down. That's why NATO also had to make sure their aircraft would return safely. And in order to do that, they had to conduct SEAD operations to open a small corridor for their planes. SEAD stands for Suppression of Enemy Air Defenses, which basically means you neutralize, destroy, or temporarily disable an enemy air defense system in a specific area by physical means like bombs and missiles, or by electronic means like electronic warfare. Now, in order to conduct SEAD operations and to open a small corridor for NATO aircraft to get in and out, the US had something called the Wild Weasel. The Wild Weasel was a code name the United States Air Force gave to any aircraft that was tasked with baiting enemy air defenses to target it with their radars, so that they could trace the radar emissions back to the source and then fire a missile at said air defense installation in order to destroy it. So the plan was to send these Wild Weasels ahead in order to clear the way, and the attacking aircraft carrying the bombs would follow them. As for the aircraft that would actually go out and strike the follow-on forces, NATO had a variety of aircraft to use. F-16s, F-4s, F-111s and the Tornado could all technically carry out such an attack. But only the Tornado and the F-111 were able to fly at night and in bad weather thanks to technology. The Tornado even had TRF, aka Terrain Following Radar, which allowed it to fly at very low altitudes like 30 meters or 100 feet above the ground. That means it could fly low and use natural terrain such as mountains, hills or valleys as cover from radar detection, just like everyone does in realistic air battles in BRs exceeding 10.0. Now comes the how do we actually destroy a formation part. NATO had different tools for different moments. One thing were cluster dispensers. War crime, by the way. You can imagine cluster dispensers as a can that opens and sprinkles hundreds of mini-bombs across a football field-sized patch. They are fabulous for soft targets like trucks, fuel bowsers, artillery pieces and the people who keep the column alive. But they are not good at destroying tanks. Typical patterns spread one bomblet every 20 square meters, and unless you land on a weak spot at the top of the tank, it would usually just shrug it off. NATO also had smart anti-tank submunitions. Those bombs were smarter than the retarded bombs. Each little bomb or munition would hunt for a tank-shaped high-temperature target and then fire a high-speed metal slug down through the thin top armor of Soviet tanks. Because each bomb searches hundreds of square meters, the pilot dropping the bomb wouldn't need perfect aim to hit the tanks. Now, important to keep in mind is that FOFA only works as a package. You need the seeing, the door kicking, and the right warhead all at once. US congressional analysts literally told the Pentagon to present FOFA as complete packages so you could see how each piece makes the others effective and what happens if a piece is missing. And that's basically it. That was NATO's plan to defend themselves against Soviet follow-on forces. Thanks for watching and don't forget to like and subscribe. And keep in mind, I will show you my ice cream if we hit 150 likes. Anyways, see you next time.